wearing a t-shirt? Are you alone? Are you with friends? Are you indoors, outdoors? There's a lot of subtle clues and signaling that you're actually personally branding yourself with your picture. But it's not just that, it's also your age, your political and religious views, activities, favorite books and movies, where you went to university, what you studied, where you work now, what your job title is. It's a lot of information out there. And the thing is, prior to the Facebook era, we just didn't share this information. I mean, if you look right now, political views and religious views is classified under basic information. I don't know about Spain, but in the US, that is not basic information. You might know someone for months and even years and not know what their religion is or not know how they vote. It's personal information. And yet now we're sharing this with people that we barely know, people that we knew a long time ago, people that we have met only once or twice at events like this or sat next to on the plane. Now we're sharing an incredible amount of information that we never did before. And this new social norm around sharing has tremendous implications, because it means, on a personal level, that we can get to know each other a lot faster. I can meet Javier, we become Facebook friends, and all of a sudden I know about his family. I know that he's Catholic. I know all of this information about him, and we almost accelerate the relationship cycle. What does this mean for business? Well, there's implications for business too, because it turns out all of this information that is on our Facebook profile, marketers and advertisers can now use to target their advertising messages. So if I am running a conference in Madrid, I can choose to target people who live in Madrid and who speak Spanish. If I sell basketballs, if I'm a manufacturer of basketballs, I can choose to target my ads just to people who tell me that they like playing basketball. Even if I want to show ads to everybody, I would want to segment my campaigns and bid more money for people who tell me they like playing basketball, because I expect a higher conversion from that. And, I mean, Facebook is just like Google. You can bid per click or per impression. But either way, we can be smarter about the way that we message what we're selling and be specific about who we want to show those messages to. But it's not just our identity on Facebook.com or on 20.com or on LinkedIn.com. Thanks to technologies like Google Friend Connect and Facebook Connect, we can bring our identities with us to other websites. And here's a couple examples. The one in the back is CitySearch.com. In the US, it's a popular restaurant and nightlife review site. CitySearch integrated with Facebook Connect, and instead of having to sign up for a username and fill out all of your information on CitySearch, you can just log in with your Facebook credentials. And all of a sudden, it'll know what your tastes are, it'll know your age, your gender, and most importantly, it knows your friends. So if I come to Madrid and I look up on CitySearch what restaurants are good, instead of just seeing a number of reviews from people that I don't know, from strangers, it could be the restaurant owner. I have no idea of telling. I can see which restaurants my Facebook friends have gone to and which ones they recommend. And maybe I trust Jose for recommendations on Basque food, and I trust Monica for recommendations on tapas. And so I can make a decision in terms of who I want to trust for what. The other example is CNN.com, which is the popular news site. In January of this year, CNN showed the live streaming video cast of President Obama's inauguration in Washington, D.C. As Chris talked about earlier, it was a historic moment, the first elected black leader of the free world. But instead of having to watch this historic moment by yourself in your cubicle or at home in your living room, you could log in with your Facebook ID and suddenly enter a conversation with your friends and see all the comments live and streaming from your Facebook friends. But it's not just websites, it's also devices like the Xbox and also airplane consoles. So Virgin Airlines recently announced that they're building a Facebook Connect application so that you can see which of your Facebook friends will be on certain flights or going to the same cities as you. That could be interesting. You know, there might be certain people you want to sit by and certain people you want to avoid. And it's pretty easy to do, too. After my book came out in April, I set up a website for the book here, and it took us just a few hours to implement Facebook Connect, and I'll show you how we used it. Let me go back here. Here's my book website. And the first way we used it was for discussion and for commenting so that people could share whatever thoughts they had on the book back to Facebook. So if I click here and enter the site, I can go down to the Facebook Connect widget, and here I can say speaking, or here. I can say, estoy hablando en Madrid. Okay, so I post this, and even though I'm on my website, because it's been integrated with Facebook Connect, when I go back to Facebook and I click on my profile or in any of my friends' news feeds, I can see that this comment has been posted. So right here. And so that is how Facebook is really trying to build that social layer across every website. And being able to bring it back to Facebook so that my friends can see that they've interacted with this other website. Okay, great. So as a result of these new technologies and these new possibilities, consumer expectations have changed. People's expectations have changed. Because they're putting information out there, they expect businesses, before you pick up the phone and make a sales call or send out an email campaign, they expect you to have done your homework and to have done your research about them. They want you to understand their industry and their region, their geography. They want you to speak the same language as them. And they certainly want you to understand the unique business problems facing their company. And so these interactions, you know, they're expected to be personalized now. It's no longer acceptable to send a generic product email and spam a big list of people. No one's going to open that email. No one's going to respond. There's also an important concept here, too, of transitive trust that I write about in my book. Transitive trust is how human beings have been making decisions, including purchase decisions, since the dawn of civilization. This is how it works. Transitive trust is if I'm trying to reach Alejandra, and I don't know Alejandra, but I can look up on LinkedIn or on Facebook that we actually know Jose Luis in common. And so I can ask Jose Luis for an introduction, or I can just mention Jose Luis when I talk to Alejandra. And how transitive trust works is because Alejandra trusts Jose Luis, and Jose Luis knows and trusts me, Alejandra is more likely to transitively trust me. Some of that trust transfers over to me. And in the past, it was extremely difficult for me to know who Alejandra and I knew in common. But social networks like Facebook changed that with a simple search. I don't have to ask around. I don't have to guess who we might know in common. I can see right away that we may know 20 or 30 people in common and use my best judgment to decide which ones of those to ask for a warm introduction. The other aspect of Facebook and Twitter from a sociological standpoint is that they really invented a new mode of communication. So things like Facebook messages and wall posts and tweets and a Facebook poke, which no one really knows what that means, these are new modes of communication that just didn't exist before. Mm-hmm. It's like when we went from in-person meetings to phone calls, and from phone calls to email, and now email to Facebook. Each time, the cost of staying in touch went down, so we stayed in touch with more people. We could call far more people on a regular basis than we can visit with one-on-one. We can email far more people than we can call or visit. And now, we can become LinkedIn connections with and Facebook friends with far more people than we can email or call or visit. And the implications here aren't so much in our inner circle. You know, our parents, our brothers and sisters, our best friends, our neighbors, those relationships will always be there. And certainly Facebook helps supplement that, and I know my mother always tracks all of my travels and speaking engagements on Facebook. But where it really makes the hugest difference is on the fringe. It's on the edge of our networks, with weak ties, with people that we barely know, where Facebook is actually making the biggest difference. Because these people, we otherwise wouldn't have the time to stay in touch with. It would be too costly. You know, if you meet someone at this event and you exchange business cards,